Welcome to SPS Hands-on session day 6. Hope so far you have gathered some knowledge regarding SPS's basics, and also you might have gathered some application knowledge regarding the various tools and how to use by making use of SPSs. In today's session, I'm going to discuss about correlation and regression analysis. Correlation and regression analysis is a widely used statistic measure in various fields such as marketing, HR, and then finance and social science, etc. So let us move to the topic without further delay. What do you mean by correlation? What do you mean by person correlation? Correlation means it is a relationship between two variables or association between two continuous variables. What do you mean by continuous variables? Continuous variables take any numeric form. Some of the examples of continuous variables, I can say as a height of a person or a weight of a person and a time and age, blood pressure level, glucose level. These are all some of the examples of continuous variables. Okay. So how will you determine this Pearson correlation value? Okay. How will you determine the relationship between two continuous variables by means of Pearson coefficient value or? This Pearson coefficient value, this determines two things. One is it determines this strength of the relationship, okay, and the other one is it determines the direction of the relationship of the two variables. So what is the value of the coefficient, Pearson coefficient value, or so the value of the coefficient value ranges from -1 to +1. Okay, so here what does the direction means? The direction indicates the positive movement or negative movement of the variables. Okay, and the strength indicates whether the relationship between the two variables are strong or weak. So basically, Pearson coefficient, the main objective of Pearson correlation coefficient is it will be finding out whether the relationship between the two variables is positive, is in positive direction, or whether it is in a negative direction, or whether it is strong or weak. So what do you mean by positive direction? What do you mean by positive direction? As one variable increases, okay, as one variable increases, then the other variable also increases. Then that is said to be positive direction or positive correlation. If R is negative, if the value of R is negative, then what does it mean? If the value of R is negative, then what does it mean? It means when one variable increases, the other variable decreases. I would like to give some example for this. Okay, so let us assume that height is the dependent variable. Height is the dependent variable where we are, as I have already told you, height is the continuous variable. Okay, so whenever the height increases, then the independent variable is weight. Okay, whenever the height increases, the independent variable weight also increases. So this is the example for positive correlation. Okay, then what is the example for negative correlation? So I can say that speed is the dependent variable. Speed is the dependent variable, and time taken to reach a particular destination is the independent variable. Okay, so the speed, whenever the speed increases, the time taken will be decreases. Okay, then what is here actually happening? Then when one variable increases, the other variable decreases. When the speed increases, the time taken by the car decreases. So this relationship between the speed and the time taken, both are continuous variable. So this relationship is called as the negative relationship. Okay, so this is the here I have given the correlation coefficient value ranges. It starts from minus one to its ranges in between minus one to plus one. So if the correlation coefficient value R is equal to zero, then we can say that there is no correlation between the two variables. Assume that if the correlation coefficient value of two variables is in between minus 5 to 0, in between minus 5 to 0, then the relationship between the two variables, two continuous variables is it's a weak negative correlation. The strength is weak and the direction here is negative. Okay, so if the correlation coefficient value ranges in between minus 5 and minus 1, then the relationship is very strong, but it is a negative correlation. Meanwhile, if it is more in the direction of green color, then that direction is called as positive direction. And if the value of the coefficient value ranges in between 0 to plus 5, then the relationship is very weak, but it is a positive correlation. If the value goes out of above 5 to 1, okay, then there is a strong relationship between the two variables. This is how we have to interpret the correlation coefficient value analysis. Okay, the value of finally we are through this analysis, we have to find out the R value. The R value will be ranges in between minus to one, and we have to interfere whether the relationship is strong or weak, whether the relationship is a positive or negative. Okay, so whenever the coefficient correlation value is one, we can interfere that there is a perfect positive correlation. So 0.9, high positive correlation. If it is a 0.5, we can infer it as a low positive correlation, and zero, then there is a no correlation between the two point, and minus 0.5, there is a low negative correlation, minus 0.9 high negative correlation. If it is minus one, then we can say it as that there is a perfect negative correlation. See, you can the slope trending downwards. If it is a negative correlation, the slope trending downwards. If it is a like a positive correlation, that it will be like upward straight line. Okay, in this graph you can see the upward straight line. If it is a negative correlation, you can see the trend of the line going sloping downwards. Okay. So this is the formula for calculating the correlation coefficient, where R is equal to summation xy minus summation x into summation y divided by n, the whole divided by root of summation x squared minus summation x the whole square divided by n into summation y squared minus summation y the whole square divided by n. Okay, so we can make use of this formula if we are calculating the value of R manually. Okay, but our intention in this workshop is to focus on a hands-on SPS session. So I'm not going to spend much time here in the explanation of this part. Just, you know, we can also calculate correlation coefficient manually. But if the data, if you're having a lot of observation, then it will be, the calculation part is difficult for you. So SPSS will be doing it in fraction of second. Okay, so whenever I do the correlation analysis, basically before doing the correlation analysis, the statistician should be very particular in fulfilling the assumptions. There are some basic assumptions in order to perform the correlation analysis. So let us discuss about the assumptions. So these are the assumptions. The two variables, as I already told you, it should be a continuous variable. That is the first assumption. And the two variables are linear. So what do you mean by two variables are linear? So whenever the changes happens in one variable, automatically the other variable also changes. Then it indicates the relationship or the two variables are linear. By that, we can come to know the two variables are linear. Okay, so this is a scatter plot. Okay, so x variables of x is plotted on the x axis, and variable of y is plotted on the y axis, and these are the data point. These are the data points of plotted against the x and y variable. And after plotting the data point, you can see if it looked like all the fall along the straight line. Okay, you can see all the point of the data point fall along the straight line here in the left side picture. Then it clearly indicates the assumption that the two variables are linear. Okay, so before performing the analysis, you have to check it. Okay, by making use of the SPSS main menu, there are some, you have to give some command scatter plot. You have to make use of the scatter plot, and then you can able to know whether the variables are linear or not. In the right hand side picture, you can see the variables are not linear, because it is scattered around. We cannot able to draw a straight line here. Okay, the third assumption is the data should be normally distributed. So what do you mean by the data should be normally distributed? Okay, so how the variable values are distributed around its mean. Which is normally distributed determines how the variable values are distributed around the mean. Okay, so the data should be like this. Okay, so it should form a bell-shaped curve. If you are looking it into the histogram, it should give a picture called as a bell-shaped curve. You should able to see bell-shaped curve. Most of the data lies within the first two standard deviation. Okay, and the remaining, that is, it covers nearly 68% of percentage of the data, and the next two deviations, okay, it covers 95% of the data, and finally the third data, okay, by adding together, the 97% of the data should fall within this three deviation of the mean. Okay, then the data can be called as normally distributed. So we have to analyze this also. We have to test this assumption also. So only after all our assumptions are met, then only you can start doing the correlation analysis. Okay, so let us do the correlation calculation by making use of SPSS. Participant can import the data. Okay, so I'm going to import the data here. Kindly import the data. Okay. So you can see two continuous variables here in this data. So one variable is exam score. It is the independent continuous variable, and the other variable is dependent variable, the hours of study, the time taken by various students, and the mark scored in the exam. Okay, so I would like to correlate if there is any relationship between the times taken for studying and this mark scored in the exam. So let us do the calculation. So we have to check the assumptions, right? So first, what is the first assumption? Can you please tell me in the chat box, what is the first assumption? What is the first assumption?
Two variables are continuous.
Yes, variables are continuous. So it is satisfied. So we have met the assumption. And the second one, chart builder, variables are linear. We want to check whether the variables are linear. So what we should do? So once again, I tell, go to graph, chart builder. Okay. Okay. Here you have to select a scatter dot. Place it here, drag it and place it in this gallery. Okay, so you will be getting this y-axis box and x-axis box. And what is our independent, what is our dependent variable? Place the dependent variable in y-axis and place the independent variable in the x-axis. Okay.
Excuse me, madam.
And can you able to see? Can you able to follow?
No, no.
Okay, 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 fine. Okay, so give okay. So outcome variable. My screen is paused. Why? Give me a second. Okay, can you able to see the outcome? Can you able to see the outcome? Yes or no?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so we are going to check the linearity, right? Please kindly right click this. Kindly right click. Okay, so left click, and you will be getting this pattern and click this. Okay, click this. Okay, now you can see the lines. We can able to draw or fit a line, best line in this data point. Okay, so we have checked the linearity. Linearity is completed. And the third one, we have to check the normality. So for checking the normality, you have to analyze descriptive statistics and explore. Okay, you have to move both the variables in the dependent list. Statistics, descriptive, continue, plot, check off normality plot with the test, continue, okay. Okay, so now we are going to find out the normality test. So Shapiro-Wilk test, we can consider both two normality tests of that, but for this test, since the sample value is less than 50, it is better that we can go with Shapiro-Wilk test. So here the significance value is above 0.05, significance value of both the variable is above 0.05. So we can infer that the data are normally distributed. So we have our next assumption. We have met all the three assumptions for the given data. So we are permitted, as a statistician, after fulfilling the assumption, we can start doing the correlation analysis. So you have asked me to repeat, isn't it? Can you please tell me which one you want to repeat? Just now I saw the message.
Excuse me, ma'am. Good evening, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Chart building, please explain, because you know, fast, so that I cannot understand.
okay. Fine.
From where
do you want me to explain?
Yes,
this
ma'am.
One.
Till
graph.
Output.
Okay. I'll tell you once again. Okay.
Ma'am, please slow.
Okay. I'll try my best to go slow. Okay. Here, first you have to put graph, chart builder, graph chart builder. Okay. Move the exam square in the Y axis and our study in the X axis. Okay. And then click OK. So you will be getting the scatter plot. you will be getting the splatter plot. Okay, so now click. Okay, so if you are clicking it, you can able to see a line. See a line. Are you getting it? Are you following it? So this is the way how you have to find out the scatter plot. The first assumption is okay, and the next assumption is normality. So we are going to test the normality. So how you have to test the normality? Normality is like analyze descriptive statistics and explore. Okay, so move both variables in this dependent list. Okay, after that, statistics, descriptive, continue. Kindly note down the path, then plot. Okay, in the plot, you have to check off normality plot. You have to check off normality plot. Then continue. After that, okay. Participant, kindly mute yourself. Okay, so we are going to we can interpret Shapiro-Wilkes test. Okay, analyze the normality, to analyze whether the data is normally distributed or not. So because the sample size is less than 50, it is better we can go with Shapiro-Wilkes. So Shapiro-Wilkes already, the other teachers might have discussed with you regarding the normality. So that is why I was a little bit fast in giving the explanation regarding this part. And in Shapiro-Wilkes test, if the significance value is greater than 0.05, then we can infer that the data is normally distributed. Okay, so two analysis. So continuous assumption we have met, and the data has met the continuous, and linear is also met, and normality has also met. The data has met the normality also. So now we can go to the main analysis. That is, we are going to find out the correlation coefficient value. That is R value. So we have x-axis, we have x variables. And we have y variables, both are continuous variable. We are going to find out the relationship between the two variables. That x variable is like study time, and y variable is, what is the y variable? Y variable is exam scores. Okay, now we are going to find out the relationship. How we have to find out? So go to SPSS part, okay. Can you able to see SPSS screen? So I'm going to tell the path for finding out the correlation coefficient R value. Kindly make note of it. Analyze, correlate, bivariate. And you have to move the variables in this variable box. Okay. And Pearson has a default ticking mark. And let it be like that only. And then others, all the markings should be there. Okay. And okay, that's it. Now, okay. Click okay. So we are going to find out the R value. Okay, so this is the, are you getting this correlation matrix? Yes or no?
Yes, ma'am.
Fine, thank you. Okay, so this is the correlation matrix. It is the correlation matrix where you can able to see the R value. So we have two variables. One is our study and exam score. Our study is the independent continuous variable, and exam score is the dependent continuous variable. So our study to our study, what is the correlation between our study to our study, Pearson correlation value? Please tell in the chat box. Correlation value of our study to our study, 1. Okay, so correlation between the same variable will be always one. Okay, but our concern is to find out the correlation between the dependent variable and independent variable. So what is the correlation between hours of study and exam score? Kindly respond through chat box. What is the correlation coefficient for hours and study and exam score? Yes. No, it's not. Yes. Niloufar Satik, it's correct. It's 0.840. It's 0.840. Somebody have given it as a 0.40. I think by mistake they have given. Yes, yes, dear participant, you are correct. This is the correlation coefficient value for this analysis. This is the R value. So by looking into the R value, which is very close to 1, that is a, so we can identify the positive relationship between the two variables, between the hours of study and examination score. Positive, strong. What is the strength of the relationship? The strength is very strong. And what is the direction of the relationship? The direction is positive. So this is the way how you have to interpret the correlation analysis. So let us, shall I go to the next part? I have completed up to the correlation coefficient value. Shall I go to move to the next? Okay, thank you. Okay. Okay. One more part I have to tell in the output. Okay. I have told you only one part. There are two output are there. So the hypothesis that I have created, that I have framed for this correlation analysis is H naught is a null hypothesis. There is a no significant linear relationship between hours of study and exam score. And the alternative is opposite of that. This is the hypothesis which I have framed for this analysis. And one part is we have to find out the correlation value, and the other analysis part, and the other analysis part, result part or outcome part is significance of the significance. Okay. I have to test the hypothesis by means of this value, p value. The p value, by making use of the p value, I can tell that whether I am going to reject the null hypothesis or not. Since the p value is less than 0.01, I have taken alpha 0.01. So I'm going to reject this, this null hypothesis, which means if I'm going to reject this null hypothesis, which means there is a significant linear relationship between hours of study and exam scores. So this is how you have to give the interpretation in the analysis part. Okay. So in the analysis part interpretation, you have to write correlation coefficient for hours and our study and exam score is 0.840. Okay, correlation coefficient R value ranges between -1 to 4, because 8.84 is between -1 to 4. Okay, so 0.840, hence a positive strong correlation. The result outcome part one, first one is you have to infer about the R value, and the part two, next outcome, the next metric which you are going to explain is about the significance, about the p value. Since the p value is less than 0.01, we can say that null hypothesis is rejected. Okay. Now let us move to.
Ma'am, I have a query, ma'am. Sorry to interrupt.
Yes, sir.
Ma'am, in this, the p-value have said like 0.01, whereas in the other test that we saw yesterday and day before, it was 0.05.
Mm.
So because alpha, we have taken 99% confidence interval.
Mm. So alpha level is like a researcher's choice. Okay. If you want to set it even for 0.05, you can set it. Okay. Then how should I reject the value? You have to reject the value. Null hypothesis is rejected at 5% level. Okay, I have taken here the alpha level. Alpha level is a 0.01. Okay, so even you can take, since p value is 0.00, even you can tell that since p value is less than 0.05, Okay, if you are writing your inference like this, instead of this 0.01, if you are mentioning here 0.05, that is also correct. Okay, you can take either 0.01 or 0.05. Okay?
Okay, ma'am. Thanks, ma'am.
Okay, fine. Okay, next one is simple linear regression. Let us move to the topic, simple linear regression. Simple linear regression is the extension, is the extension of correlation. So the word simple insists here that it is the relationship between one independent variable and one dependent variable. Okay, so one independent variable, both are here also, both variables are continuous. Okay, so and the word linear indicates that describes the relationship between one variable and other variable using a straight line. Linear means how the relationship is determined between two variables by means of a straight line or by using a straight line. Here, the independent variable can also be called as predictor variable, explanatory variable, or independent variable. And the dependent variable can also be called as response variable or outcome variable, etc. Okay. So, the main objective of simple linear regression is, the first one is it will analyze the relationship between the independent variable and dependent variable. That is the first objective. And the second objective is it can able to predict the value of dependent variable based on the independent variable. The prediction is the second function or second characteristics of simple linear regression. So basically it can able to associate two variables as well as it can able to predict the outcome variable based on the independent variable. Okay, so what is the difference between simple linear regression and correlation? What is the basic difference? Correlation, it will study only about the association. Cause and effect relationship is not possible in correlation. But here, cause and effect study is possible. What is the changes that happens in dependent variable when the value of independent variable changes? It will give the answer for this. So the independent variable can able to predict the value of the dependent variable. So that is the specialty of simple linear regression. So basically a regression model, I can summarize that basically regression model are used to describe the relationship between the two variables by fitting a line in the observed data. Okay, when one variable changes, independent variable changes, the dependent variable also changes. Okay, so in the given example, X variables in the x-axis and y variable is in the y-axis, and there is a straight line. So this straight line is called as regression line. This is the regression line. So this is called as the line of best fit. This is called as the line of best fit. It refers to the line through the scatter plot. This line that is drawn through the scatter plot of data point. Okay, so this line best expresses the relationship between the two variables. So the independent variable here is stress score, and the dependent variable is blood pressure. Okay, both are continuous variable. So just I have given this as an example. So by drawing the regression line, I can able to predict the blood pressure level by means of the X variable, by means of the stress score. Okay, so this is the regression line. So one thing we have to know about we should know about simple linear regression is the simple linear regression equation for the regression line. So in your high school mathematics, you might have learned equation for a straight line, isn't it? So it is the y is equal to mx plus c. So in statistics, the same thing can be expressed as y is equal to beta naught plus beta 1x. This is the main thing which we have to know in the regression analysis. Okay, by making use of this regression equation only, we can able to predict the outcome. So the main important thing is you have to know about the regression equation. Regression equation is y is equal to beta naught plus beta 1 into x. Okay, let me give me the detail regarding or explanation regarding the metrics of this regression line. So y is the outcome variable. Y is the outcome variable or the dependent variable. And this beta naught is the intercept. It can be called as intercept or constant value. So what is the value of y? What is the value of y when x is equal to 0? So beta is nothing but what is the value of y when x is equal to 0? So beta 1 is the slope of this regression line. So we have to find out this coefficient. Okay, that is our duty in this regression analysis. The main thing which we are going to find out is beta 1 and beta naught. Okay, so y is the dependent variable. So I have already explained this to you. So let us move. I can give you the live example for this. How I am going to find out the regression equation for the given data. Okay, so this is the example. I have taken nearly 7 e-commerce stores. And each e-commerce stores I have taken their e-commerce monthly sales of some product. Okay, as well as I have taken the data of what is the online advertisement cost they are spending for each month. So number one is 368 sales, while the online advertisement they have spent is for nearly $1.7. Okay, so I have taken 7 data. So I want to know about the relationship between these two. Okay, whether I can able to predict the sales for any given x value. So how should I find out? So in order to find out, I have already told you, I should know about the regression equation. So I should manually, just for example, I have given this value. So calculation part, I will tell you next. Okay. While explaining the SPSS, I will tell you. So here, after doing the calculation, I have find out the value for beta naught is 125.8 and value for beta 1 is 171.5 into x. Okay, this is the regression equation. Okay, for example, I told you I can predict y. For example, if the advertisement cost, okay, like I want to predict what may be my sales. If I spend rupees 2000, if I spend $2000 for my advertisement, if I spend 2000, what may be the sales level for my company? I want to predict that. Okay, so for that, I can apply that variable. I can apply that X variable here. I can substitute that X variable in this equation. I can predict the Y dependent variable, that is sales. So it has to be expressed in 1000 as it is given here as 1000. So 469 into 1000. Okay, this is the regression equation. So manually we can do the calculation. We have some formulas for this beta naught and beta 1. So you have to find out the values and simply substitute here. But I don't want to focus here. So I can go directly to SPSS and I can explain you how to do the calculation for regression analysis. Okay, so while talking about the correlation analysis, I told there are some basic assumptions, isn't it? So similarly, in regression analysis also, we have some basic assumptions. Okay, so what are those basic assumptions? Let me tell one by one. The first one is linear relationship, normally distributed, no multicollinearity, no autocorrelation, no heterozygosity. Okay, So in a brief explanation, I can tell you that we already know that linear relationship. I have already discussed with you in my correlation part, explanation part. The same thing explanation will be here also. Okay, so that should be a linear relationship between the independent variable x and the dependent variable y. How can we able to find out this linear relationship with the help of scatter plot? Okay, so SPSS will do for you. And the next one is residual values are independent. There should not be any autocorrelation. So this you can able to find out whether this assumption has met or not by making use of Durbin-Watson test. Okay, and the third one is there should not be any multicollinearity. There should not be any multicollinearity between the independent variables. So this we can test in SPSS by making use of collinearity diagnostics. And the fourth assumption is the residual should have a homozygosity behavior. It should not have heterozygosity behavior. Okay, this you can able to find out by making use of normal probability plot. Okay, the last one is values of the residuals are normally distributed. Okay, so this also you can, by making use of normal PP plot, you can able to find out whether the assumption has met or not. So these are the different assumptions. So let me explain one by one. So assumption one, I have already explained to you the variables, the data point. If you are looking at the data point, you should see that it should fall along the straight line. Okay, then we can say that the variables are linear. So that is the first assumption for simple linear regression. So while moving to the next assumption, I told you that residual values are independent. So there should not be any correlation between the residual values. So before moving into this assumption, you should know, or we should know, what do you mean by residuals, first of all. So what do you mean by residuals? So I have drawn two variables are there. Okay, here two variables are there, x variable and y variable. So this is the regression line. Black line is the regression model or regression line. By making use of this formula, okay, by making use of this formula, the statistical tool SPSS will come with this regression line. Okay, so this regression line, this is the black is the regression line. Then what is the red line? The red line, this is the vertical distance between the model and the actual data point. Okay, so what do you mean by residual actually? Our residual is the vertical distance between, it is the vertical distance between our data point here and the a data point and the regression line. Residual is nothing but a vertical, a distance between the, this is the actual data point. And here in the black line starting point, this is the predicted data point. So this distance is called as residuals. Okay. And how well the regression model fits the data. Okay. How well the regression model fits this data. That is dependent on how much closer our data point or to this straight line. If your data points are very close, if your residual distance is very close, okay, then you can infer that, then you can tell that this is the line of best fit. Okay. So the distance between the data point and regression line is called as residuals. So the next, this is how the SPSS calculate the regression line. Okay, it will do various trial and error method. Okay, so I told you regression distance should be very, very nearby. Okay, the points, the data point should be very nearby the regression line. The residual distance should be very less. Then your regression model is the best fit. So SPSS will do various calculation and it will finally pick the best fit regression. It will come with the best coefficient values. So the beta value and alpha, the beta value, beta naught and beta one value, it will come with the best value. Okay, in such a way that the distance between the all data points will be very, it will be very closer to the regression line. So residual is nothing but the distance between the actual data points and the predicted line, data regression line. And our next assumption is values of the residual should be normally distributed. So kindly note that it is not the values of the, it is not the variables. Variables should be normally distributed. It is values of the residual. So residual is nothing but the distance. Okay, distance between the data point and the regression line. This values, this value, variable value should be normally plotted, normally distributed. So normal distribution we already know. So the histogram should show you a bell-shaped curve. And if you're drawing the normal PP plot, probability plot, then the point should fall near the line or along the line or on the line. Okay, it can be like this. It is very nearby the line. Then we can call it as a normally distributed. The residual values are normally distributed. Okay, so two assumptions. After finding out the two assumptions, we are moving to the third assumption. Okay, what is the third assumption? Third assumption is there should not be any multicollinearity between the independent variable. Not, we are not talking about residual here. So we are talking about the independent variable. Okay. So the independent variables should not be correlated with each other. That is the main assumption here. So if both independent, what happens if both independent or there may be two or three independent value, if you're taking multiple regression, there will be more independent variable. Okay. If all the independent variables, some of the two independent variables are highly correlated, then both the independent variable will give the same information to the regression line. Okay, then the regression line will not give the accurate prediction. Okay, then our result may go wrong. Okay, it will go wrong. So in order to avoid that, we have a test called as collinearity diagnostics. Okay, so collinearity diagnostics, we will be having a VIF value, okay, variability inflation value, VIF, okay, variable inflation factor, and tolerance score, okay. So the rule of thumb for acceptable range for VIF score should be below 10, and tolerance score should be above 0.2. This is the basic rule of thumb, or otherwise called as acceptable range for multicollinearity. Okay, so multicollinearity is nothing but if the independent variables are highly correlated, then it will spoil or it will screw up the regression line. Then the prediction rate will not be accurate. So there should not be any multicollinearity between the independence variable. If the independence variable are highly correlated, their information will be duplicated. The duplication of information will definitely screw up the regression line. So the assumption three is multicollinearity. We can check this by making use of collinearity diagnostics test in SPSS. And I have given the acceptable range value. The next one is residual values are independent. Okay, here the independent values should not correlate. Okay, in this assumption, here the residual values should not correlate. Okay, they should not be correlated. The same thing, if it is correlated, what has happened? The accuracy, the prediction rate accuracy, the outcome value, the result which you are giving, the prediction rate of independent variable will not be that much correct, exact correct. Okay, we don't want that. We need a accurate prediction rate. That is why we are involving ourselves in the research. So how we can find out this kind of whether the residual values are autocorrelated, whether there is a dependency between the two residual values? We can able to find out by making use of Durbin-Watson test. Okay, Durbin-Watson test value ranges from 0 to 4. A rule of thumb for this test is it can be between 1.5 to 2.5. Okay, only the thing is if the value of Durbin-Watson test is below 1 or above 1, then we can say that the data point have not met the assumption. Okay, so these are the rule of thumb for Durbin-Watson test. And then moving to the assumption 5. The assumption 5 is heterozygosity. Okay, there should not be any heterocydasticity. So I have drawn a data points. One is the prediction value and the other one is the residual values. Okay, I have plotted the prediction values and residual values. And after these x or the like residual values, okay, and the distance between the residual and I have drawn a straight line, and the distance between this data point and the line, this is called as variance. Okay, this is called as variance. When the x axis increases, when the value of x axis increases, you can see the variance, the distance between the line and the data point also increasing. Okay, so this kind of residual value behavior, this is a divergent behavior where you can see a pattern here. It is a funnel pattern, a divergent pattern. This behavior will not give the correct outcome. Okay, our prediction accuracy will not be accurate if our data, if your residual values are like, if it is showing the heterocydasity behavior, then our prediction value will not be accurate. So what is suggested? It is that this variance values should be constant. Okay, it should be look like a random arrangement. Random. There should not be any funnel shape, divergent pattern or invergent pattern. We should not see while seeing the graph, while visualizing the graph for this data, for this residual data, you should see only the right hand side picture. In your SPSS test, you should able to see only the right hand side picture. Then you can do the analysis. Otherwise, you should stop doing the analysis. So your residual point should show the homocidacity behavior. So that is very important. So in this way, fulfilling all these assumptions, you can go to the regression analysis. Okay, now let me move to the analysis part. So let us do the simple linear regression analysis. I'm going to import the data. So all of you kindly take simple linear regression analysis. Regression analysis.
And the screen is not visible.
Okay. Please give me a time. Dear participant, can you able to see now? Okay. Yeah. Okay. I'm going to change the data. This is the correlation data. I want to import file, open. Kindly noted file, open data. Okay, I have various data. From this data, I want simple linear regression. So open it. Okay, so this is the simple linear regression. So the both variables are continuous variable, the study hours and the time and the score. Okay, the study hours, the variable is study hours and the scores. This is just like a correlation. The only one difference is here prediction is also passable in simple linear regression. So I want to analyze whether there is a relationship between the study hour and the score taken by the student. That is my first idea. And my second objective for this study is I want to know whether I can able to predict the score by making use of hours. Okay, if I spend 2 hours, how much mark I can take. This is the thing what I want to predict through this analysis. For this, I am going to do the simple linear regression. So coming to the path, okay, analyze.
Ma'am, nothing
analyze.
Visible.
You cannot see anything?
No, ma'am. Blank is there.
Okay. Wait. Can you able to see?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so study hours and scores. Okay, study hours and score. So this is the continuous variable again. Two variables are continuous. Here I want to know the relationship between the both variables, as well as I want to know whether the study variables. For if I study for three hours, what may be my score? I need that prediction. Okay, so that is why I'm going to do this simple linear analysis. So kindly make note of the path for this analyze, regression, analyze, regression, linear, analyze, regression, linear. Are you doing it? Are you following it? Analyze, regression, linear. Okay, so I have to move dependent variable. I have to move the dependent variable. What is the dependent variable here? Tell me in chat box. What is the dependent variable here?
Scores.
Scores move to, correct. Then independent variable. Okay. So the next one is statistics. Estimate, model fit. Kindly note. First, I'm clicking the statistic, estimate, model fit. I told you collinearity diagnostic test for assumption, and click the collinearity diagnostic and click the Durbin-Watson for assumption. Okay. And continue. Estimate, model fit, collinearity diagnostic, Durbin, continue. Okay. Statistics. After that, next I'm moving to plot. Move the ZR to Y and ZP to X. Okay. And plot histogram normality. I repeat, go to plot, click plot. Z prediction, Z residual move to Y, and Z prediction move to X. Okay. Then click histogram and normality probability plot. Okay, for checking our assumptions, we have to click this, continue. Okay, so, and finally, okay. Just give it okay. Okay. Right, you'll be getting the output. Are you getting this output, yes or no? Please tell me, are you getting this output? Okay, thank you. Okay, so in this outcome part, we are going to various table will come. You no need to bother about that. The main thing I'm going to discuss about is the ANOVA table, and this model summary, ANOVA and coefficient table. These are the important thing which we have to interpret for our analysis part. Okay. Okay, the first one will explain about the model summary. Okay, have you taken this? I'm going to copy and paste it in my slide, and I will be going to explain this. Kindly note this. So assumption are met. Our assumption are met. In the outcome, you can see his bell-shaped histogram. Okay. So residuals are normally plotted. And then normal PP plot. The points are along the straight line. So residuals are normally plotted. So this is the like one of the assumption we have met. Okay. And see, this is for homozygosity test. Okay. This is for homozygosity. So click, double click. If you are double click, do the left click, double click, kindly do it. Okay, and click this, add a fit line. Click add a fit line. Okay, it's not coming. Okay, I'll do it. Okay. So, So these are the different graphical representation, through visualization, you can able to see whether our data is normally plotted. Here, you can able to see the homozygosity behavior. There is no any funnel shaped pattern here. This is the homozygosity behavior. Okay. Okay, now let us move to the three main outcome, that is model summary, ANOVA, and coefficient.
Ma'am, once again explain that procedure, ma'am.
Yes. Can you able to see SPSS screen?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So analyze descriptive statistics. Sorry, analyze regression linear. Okay, analyze regression linear. And you have to move the dependent variable and independent variable, statistics, collinearity, Durbin, continue. Plot. Here already I have moved. Continue. Then okay. Okay, you'll be getting this outcome. So you have to see the three. Here normality is assumption or met. And here homozygosity behavior. If you draw a line, there is a random appearance here. There will not be any. Pattern behavior is there. If you draw a line, if this you can see the just because the observation is very low, we cannot able to clearly predict the homozygosity behavior. Okay, but it is a homozygosity behavior pattern. Okay, so all the our assumptions are met. So we have to interpret only the important three outcome. Other outcomes. Okay, you're not seeing that outcome now. I'll explain. Okay, so this is the outcome. You can able to see the dependent that is normality test visualization and homozygosity visualization. So here the data are normally distributed. There is no any funnel pattern behavior, divergent behavior of the residual values. Okay, so all the visualization clearly depicts that there is a normality distribution of residual values and there is a homozygosity behavior. There is no heterogeneity behavior. Homozygosity behavior is there. So now moving to the inference of this part, model summary, ANOVA, and coefficient. This is the important thing in the simple linear regression where this table will tell you whether the equation that we are going to find out the regression equation. This coefficient table will tell you the regression equation. So let us move to that interpretation part. Okay. So after the assumption, so this is the outcome of my simple linear regression. I have pasted the outcome here. So we are going to interpret only this through three tables. Okay, so one is model summary table and the other one is ANOVA table and the third one is coefficient table. The first one is model summary table. Okay, so in the model summary table, you have to interpret only for R and R square and Durbin VATS. No need to bother about this adjusted R square and standard error of estimate. So for the R and R square is very important in model summary. What do you mean by R? So the value of R is nothing but the multiple correlation coefficient. It can be called as multiple correlation coefficient. So this R value represent the relationship between the study hour and score. We have two variable, one is study hour and score. This R value represent the correlation between the two variables. Okay, so here the correlationship is 0.705. okay, so a value of correlation greater than 0.4, if the value of correlation is greater than 0.4, then it is taken for further analysis we can do. And here the value of correlation correlation between the two value is 0.705, where it is a good. Okay, there is a there is a positive correlation between the two variables. And what do you mean by R square? R square is that, like, it is just the square of, R square is nothing but it is the square of the correlation value. Okay, so R square will be always, it will be between 0 to 100%. It will be, R square will be always 0 to 100%. What is this R square actually? This R square is nothing but it actually explains the degree which the independent variable, the degree which the independent variable explains the dependent variable. What do you mean by that? What do you mean by that? So if there is a 49% of changes, okay, 49% of changes in scores is due to the changes in the study hours. This is the real, this is the meaning for this. What is the meaning for this 0.497? It is nothing but it is the degree which the independent variable, that is here independent variable is study hours, explains the dependent variable, dependent variable, that is score. So 49.7% of increase in score, okay, increase in score is explained by the independent variable called as study hours. So whenever the study hours increases, then it will make changes in the scores. So that scores is nothing but how the study hours influence the scores. Here 49% of 7% of influence can be seen here. So this is the interpretation for R square. So in the model summary, we have to consider two metrics. One is R. R is nothing but it will be telling about the relationship between the study hour and score. And R square is nothing but how the independent variable, how, what percentage it will affect the dependent variable. Student, kindly mute yourself. Student, participant, kindly mute yourself. Okay. And the next one is ANOVA table. The ANOVA table, here ANOVA table, the main thing which we have to look into it is the significance. Okay, significance. Here the significance is 0.01, okay, which is less than 0.05 or less than 0.01. So here in what we here I have created, I have framed one. Okay, for testing the null hypothesis. So for ANOVA, I have framed a okay, for ANOVA, I have framed one hypothesis. Okay, so based on that, we can reject. What is the hypothesis? What is the hypothesis? The regression model does not fit the data better. The regression model does not fit the data better. The regression model fits the data better. Since the regression value, since the significance value is less than 0.01, I can reject the null hypothesis, which means the regression model fits the data better. The regression model fits the data better. Why? In the ANOVA table, the significance level is less than 0.001. Okay, various other metrics are sum of squares, degree of freedom, mean square, and F value. If you want to reject it, first you have to see the significance level, then you can see the F statistics. How will you get this F statistic? By dividing the regression mean square and the residual mean square. If you divide this, you no need to do this. SPSS analysis will do. Just for your understanding, I'm telling this. Okay, if you divide regression mean square by residual mean square, then you will be getting the F value. F value, if it is greater than 2.5, you can reject the, and the significance level is less than the alpha level, then you can reject the hypothesis. That is, the regression model well fits the data. Through this analysis table, ANOVA table, I can tell that the regression model which I have created its model well fits the data. Already this there is a good correlation. My R square also 49%, it is explaining, giving the explanation. And the ANOVA, that is a significant, the model is fit the data. Best fit model, I can say this. Then in the third table, I'm going to find out the coefficient or regression coefficient. Regression coefficient. Okay, so this is the third table, that is coefficient table. So coefficient table, we have two types. Okay, one is unstandardized coefficient and the other one is standardized coefficient. You no need to bother about standardized coefficient beta. Okay, you no need to bother about standardized coefficient beta. You have to consider only the unstandardized coefficient beta. Okay, beta. So the constant value is here is given. Okay, beta naught value. So what is your regression equation? Regression line equation is y is equal to beta naught plus beta 1x, isn't it? So I have to find out my beta naught value and beta 1 value. I have to find out my beta naught value and beta 1 value. Statistics package SPSS will give the values. SPSS will give the values in the coefficient table. Okay, you have to take only the unstandardized coefficient value. Okay, and here constant value is beta naught and it is 73.434 and the coefficient of x, that is B1 value is 3.497 B1. So in this equation, we have find out beta naught and beta 1 value. So we can easily find out the y value hereafter because we have got both values, both coefficient values. Okay. And last metric, this is the collinearity statistic. I told that tolerance, if the tolerance value should not be below -2, should not be below -2. Okay, tolerance value should not be below -2. And VAF value should be below 10, should be below 10. Okay, it should be below 10. So it's satisfied. Our assumption has met. So it's satisfied. So which means there is no collinearity. By looking into this column, we can able to say there is no collinearity in the data. And we have also find out the beta naught value and beta 1 value. Okay. So I have find out the equation. I have find out the equation. Score is equal to 73.434 plus 3.497 into study hours. Here instead of x, you can write as a study hours. Okay, so 3.497 here, 3.497 is B1 and 7.434 is beta naught. Okay, so what do you mean by this? What do you mean by this? Whenever that one unit increases in one in x value, whenever the study hour increases by one unit, whenever the study hour, see the x equation here, whenever the study hour increases by one unit, then the score will increases by 3.497 units. So this is what we want. Okay. So through this regression equation, we can able to predict. Okay. So whenever the study hour increases by one unit, I can say that the score will increases by 3.497. So for example, I want to see if I study for three hours, then what will be my exam score? Okay, for this, what should I do? I should simply substitute the three hour in this x value. Okay, in this x, in this equation. So 73.434 plus 3.497 into 3. So I am simply substituting the x value and I am going to predict the unknown y value. So what is the score value? If the under this equation regression line, the score may be 83.925. So in this way, I can predict by making use of the regression equation, I can able to predict the y value based on x value. So what is your what the SPSS will do? how the SPSS will assist to find out this prediction by giving the values of beta naught and beta 1. You have to consider only unstandardized coefficient. And in this table, you can see the collinearity statistics also. Let us move to the, hope you are following all this interpretation. Let us move to the multiple linear regression. So kindly go to SPSS. Can you able to see? Yes or no?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Thank you. So now I'm going to open data, multiple regression. Okay. So what is the difference between multiple regression and linear regression? So in linear regression, you will be finding out there will be a relationship between one dependent variable and one independent variable. But in multiple linear regression, there will be more than two independent variable. Okay, there will be two or more than two independent variable and only one dependent variable. So I want to analyze whether there is a relationship between the two independent variables, that is hours given by a student, taken by a student for studying, and the preparation exams that he has taken. If both of this kind of independent variable have any relationship with the score he has, the mark that he has scored in the exam. So here I have taken one more variable called as the preparation exams that he has taken. Okay, so I want to analyze. Screen is not visible. It's black. Okay, I share it once again. Okay. Can you able to see now?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. See, here three variables. Okay, two variables are there. Two independent variable and one dependent variable. Multiple linear regression is means two or more independent variable we can take. In simple linear regression, I told you only one independent and one dependent. Here, multiple regression, we can able to find out the relationship and prediction between two or more independent value and one dependent value. Okay, for this, what you have to do, analyze, same. There is nothing new, same procedure. Whatever you have applied for, simple linear regression, same. So I want to go fast. I'm going it fast. Kindly follow the same path. Analyze, regression, and linear. Same path, analyze, regression, linear. Please do it. Analyze, I repeat, analyze, regression, linear. Have you done it? Analyze, regression, linear. Have you done it? Move the final exam scores here in the dependent and hours and preparation. Hours, independent, preparation, independent. Okay, are you following? Are you doing it? Yes or no? Okay, same thing. Estimate, model, collinearity, Durbin-Watson. Estimate, model, collinearity, Durbin-Watson. Okay, and continue. Okay, and plot.
Ma'am, please repeat from the beginning, no? From analyze.
Okay, analyze. I'll do it once again, please. Analyze, regression, linear. Analyze, regression, linear. Move the final exam scores dependent and hours independent, preparation independent. Okay, then moving to statistics. First one, estimate. Model fit, collinearity diagnostics, and Durbin-Watson, and continue. Are you following it? And then plot, is it residual and is it prediction? Histogram, normality, continue. Is it okay? And give it okay. Okay, so I'm moving to the outcome variable. Can you able to see? Can you able to see the? Can you?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Okay. So here, this is the. Here the same thing. So in the previous simple linear regression, I have give explanation for three part, right? The same explanation, same part only, same table only. You will be getting model summary, ANOVA, and coefficient. Kindly, you should ensure that whether your data has met all other assumptions. Okay, that here that normality should be. You should check normality. You should check homozygosity. Okay, and every other thing like collinearity test, Durbin-Watson test, everything you should check. So this is the output for the multiple regression linear. So now I'm going to the interpretation part for multiple linear regression analysis. Okay. First of all, the main difference in multiple linear regression is the equation. You have to add one more, you have to add the variables. So here we have, if you have two variables, means our equation is y is equal to beta naught plus beta 1 x1 plus beta 2 x2. If our model, if we have taken more than two, then you have to write beta naught plus beta 1 x1 plus beta 2 x2 plus beta 3 x2. So this is the only change. Otherwise, all the other things, how we have to proceed it with is the same. The only difference is the equation. We have to add the independent variables. That's it. Same explanation. Y is equal to dependent variable. Beta naught is y intercept. X1 is the first independent variable. And xn is the last independent variable. What do you mean by beta 1? X coefficient and beta naught. This is just a constant. Okay. So SPSS will calculate all these values and you have to, and the calculation part will be in the coefficient table. So in a regression analysis, you have to mainly look into three table. One is model summary, ANOVA, and coefficient. Okay. Model summary, ANOVA, and coefficient. The model summary will give the interpretation for R and R square. What do you mean by R? The relationship between the independence variable and dependent variable. It is a strong and positive correlation because the value is 0.8, which is near to 1. Okay, and R square value. What I told, 71% of independent dependent variable is influenced by the independent variable. Okay, so 71% of the independent dependent variable, that's exam scores. Okay, this will be influenced by this two independent variables, preparatory exam taken and hours spent for studying. Okay, this two independent variables are influencing the final exam scores by 71.7%. So this is the understanding of this model summary matrix. Okay. And then ANOVA table. Coming to the ANOVA table, we have to see the significance level. If the significance level is less than 0.01, then we can say the model best fit the data. Because the significance level is below 0.01. So, and the F value is also more than 2.5. Okay, more than 2.5. So overall, the F statistic value tell about whether your model best fit the data. Okay, here I have already told you, how will you get this F value? By dividing the mean square of regression and mean square of residual, you will be getting the F value. So look into the F value and the corresponding significance level. So we can say that the model is good. Overall, the model is good. Okay, and in this table, this is the unstandardized coefficient value. I have already asked you to consider the unstandardized coefficient. So similarly, for this multiple regression also, kindly consider only the unstandardized coefficient beta value. So B constant, the 67.63 is the constant beta naught. Okay, this is B1, this is B2. Okay, so this is our equation. Kindly note this. This is the regression equation. SPSS has calculated beta naught, beta 1, and lost beta 2 value. Okay, so what is the constant value here? Constant value is 67.633. So you have to substitute the constant value in the equation. Okay, and assumption value. You have to see the collinearity, tolerance value, and VIF value. And here VIF value is should be below 10. Should be below 10. So here both VIF value are below 10 value only. And the tolerance scores should be above 0.2. So here both are above 0.2. So which means there is no collinearity in the data. So and then coming to the coefficient, we have find out the beta, that is constant value. Then the next value is beta 1, 5.635. And what is the beta 2 value? Minus 0.584. Beta 2 value is minus 5.84. So we have to simply substitute the value. We have to simply substitute the value here. Beta naught, where XPSS has given you the value, you have to simply substitute it. And what do you mean by X1 here? Study hours. What do you mean by X2 here? That is a preparatory examination. So coefficient of X1 is 5.635. Here it is. Take it and just substitute it in the equation. And the coefficient of X2 is, see the coefficient of X2? Coefficient of X2 is minus 0.584, where it is in the table, in the under the unstandard coefficient beta value, you can see minus 0.584. Kindly, you have to simply substitute the value. So in this way, by simply substituting the coefficients in the regression equation, you can easily predict the scores. So I have considered two independent variable. One is study hours and preparation time, preparation exam taken for the taken before the exam. I want to know whether I can able to predict my dependent variable with this independent variable. Okay, so for example, I have taken two times preparatory exam. Okay, I have taken 2 time preparatory exam and I have spent 3 hours before the study, before the exam. So I want to know if I spend 3 hours before the exam and if I have taken two preparatory exam, then what will be my score? Okay, what will be my score? So I want to predict. So for this, I can make a use of this equation. I have to substitute the beta value and beta 2 value. And finally, I can get the Y value. So if you are substituting and if you are doing the calculation, you will be getting the score called as 83.37. So which means for 3 hours of study and two preparatory exam taken, my score will be 83.37. So in this way, I can do the prediction by making use of more than two variables in case of multiple linear regression. Thank you, dear participant. And by this, I have completed my session. Thanks a lot for patient listening. Yes.
In this exact screen, what you're showing, does that mean that the preparatory exam is inversely related to
yes. I want to tell that also. Very good question and very good doubt. And actually, it is like, since it is showing the negative sign, okay, so the prediction may not be accurate. Okay, the prediction may not be accurate because it is showing a negative sign. So if the negative sign comes for one independent variable, you can better remove the independent variable because you cannot give the right prediction. You cannot tell that 83.37 score will be accurate. Okay, it will definitely, the regression estimation will be wrong because you have included a negative sign variable, independent variable. Okay, it is in order to give the prediction, better remove the variable and only ours can give you the correct prediction. Dear student, if you have any, dear participant, if you have any other clarification, kindly you can ask me. If I am able to answer, I will do my best to give you answer. So you can various other regression. If your data is not meeting or if you are unable to fulfill your assumption, there are some way for that also. Okay, there is some non-parametric test is also there. So you can make use of that also. So any doubt, dear student?
Hello, ma'am.
Yes, yes.
What are the other non-parametric test equivalent?
Yes. Like we have for multiple linear regression, we have non-parametric test called as ridge regression. Okay, there is a non-parametric test which is a alternative for this multiple linear regression. But in SPSS, you cannot able to do that. For that, you have to depend on SAS, or otherwise you can also make use of our open source statistical software. So by making use of those statistical software, you can able to do that ridge regression analysis. And for linear simple linear regression analysis, you have Kendall-Theil regression. Okay, so the substitute or alternative for simple linear regression, if your data is not fulfilling the assumption, then you can make use of Kendall-Theil regression analysis. Okay, it is a non-parametric test where you can substitute, or it is alternative test for simple linear regression, where it will check the two continuous variable, where it will test, where the it can able to predict the dependent variable, even though if the data are normally, not normally distributed, even or if it is not linear.
Thank you, ma'am. Since morning, I'm struggling with my data. Data is not normally distributed. So I was in problem.
That is what. You have various other options are there now. Latest modern regression tools are there, sir.
Since morning 7 o'clock, 5 o'clock, I was in dilemma. Thank you very much. I have attended so many lectures, but your lecture is very, very explanatory, very useful. I have learned lots of things from your lecture, ma'am.
Thank you for your compliments, sir. And Niloufar, thank you, Niloufar, ma'am. And Shantilal, ma'am, thank you. Thanks a lot.
Ma'am, in multiple
Balaji, sir, thank you, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am.
Ma'am, in multiple regression, the prediction may not be accurate. That it is, the estimation is wrong. You told ma'am.
So prediction.
Is only the right prediction.
I told you, no, in simple linear regression, both the value, the all the coefficient values are in positive. Okay, here it is a negative sign symbol is showing. Okay, so since it is showing the negative sign, we cannot say the prediction is may be correct. So that is the reason.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Kusum.
Thank you very much.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Balaji, sir. So, yeah. Anything you want to convey to me? So, in this analysis, you have to concentrate only on these three tables. Okay, model, ANOVA, and coefficient. By making use of this coefficient, you can find out the beta values. And finally, you can substitute in the regression equation and finally find out the finally predict the dependent variable. Definitely, ma'am. The organizer will decide about that, and if they are permitting, definitely we will send you the recording. Okay. Thank you, dear participant. Thank you for patiently listening my session. So with this, I'm ending the session.
Thank you, Dr. Supa, for the useful session. So we end the session here. Tomorrow we have session on factor analysis. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, sir.